Hello,
What's
ladies
up,
and
guys?
gentlemen. Whoa, hey, hang on. I'm doing the intro. You stay quiet. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the Oceanic University Championship. We're into the second match of the New Zealand qualifying finals. It's a best of three series. We just saw from University of Auckland Dream take out the first game against University of Auckland Woofer Doge. Walk us through the game, Pixie.
Oh, sorry, I had to thumb my mic off mute for a second there. Last game was just a really dominant performance from Dream. There's no two ways about it. To the point where they were, without wanting to badmouth them or anything, to the point where they were able to play a little bit sloppy and maybe made some suboptimal plays, plays that are generally too risky that would normally go punished. And of course, Doge kind of left them unpunished. So I would be very interested to see if Woofer Doge here, rather than seeking to ban out Dream, just let them have whatever they will have and punish the over-aggressive play a little bit more heavily now that they've seen how Dream operate.
I'm not 100% sold on that plan, though, because against Dream, you have to ban Alistar. Barkbuck is just too much of a monster on that. Nidalee I agree with, because in the last game, we did see OC1 play an absolute monstrous Nidalee jungle. Because Dream, they've got blue side this time. Instead of going for Rumble for a ban, no, they're going to go for Rumble. They could have first picked it and taken it away, but that only works if your top laner is able to work it well. But coming up from the other side, we've got Elise Morgana. What are your thoughts on those bans coming out?
I mean, last time they banned out the Thresh, which to me says that they are giving Peng Yiliang a lot of respect. He still played a very good game on Leona. Unfortunately, he was punished by a few Zenith Blades landing on Liberty, who of course was on Vayne, and he would kind of tumble away and just put Peng in even more danger. So, I think they could ban out supports, but they're clearly comfortable, Dream at least, they're clearly comfortable just playing the lane as effectively as possible against whatever support does get picked. Xin Zhao, though, as the last ban out,
it could be a thing. In any case, though, that's three bans just targeted straight at the jungle across both teams, and it's going to really limit a lot of the jungle pools, so we'll have to see which jungler is able to capitalize more on that. With Doge, they're not going for a jungler first pick, so it looks like they're not too worried about Bonky Bonky's champions being taken away from him by Dream. They're looking to pick up that victor, and I definitely agree with that, because Tamjong Q, without his Rumble, he's going to be forced back onto that Orianna, and that's something that can be worked around. Doge can definitely look for some kind of other players to work around that, and Victor is going to be the mid laner to be able to do that.
I absolutely agree with that, and of course Victor was banned out last time, and I brought this up last time as well. Victor is Mr. Flexibility. You can put him into just about any team comp. He's just good, to put it in its simplest terms. I don't really know what more to say in regards to that, you know, aside from just, yeah, he's very flexible. I like the Thresh pickup here, actually, though, from the side of Dream. Last time they banned it out against Peng, and I did mention that it wasn't banned out this time. So I think taking it away from him is, I guess, the next best thing.
Yeah, I definitely agree there. And, you know, also picking up the Lee Sin, taking that away from Bonky Bonky, very likely a champion it's a champion that a lot of junglers are very comfortable on, and really fits into a lot of team comps. Lee Sin's very versatile, brings a strong early game. Taking that away from him while also picking up all those strengths for 021 and the rest of Dream is going to be a nice, excellent asset there. And with Talon being locked in, let's talk about that.
I'm not sure I have a lot to say about it. I like the Annie pickup. I'm assuming we're going to see that as a support. Though perhaps not the most versatile of supports. The Talon, though,
that's a blind pick Talon.
Is that maybe going to be going into the top lane, as tentatively as I say that?
It's still a blind pick, though. You're picking it into a lane where you don't know the opponent, and you're giving Dream all the options to work around that. What are they going to pick to deal with the Talon? I mean, there are so many champions that can punish melee champions, or are just better as a melee top laner. It can deal with the assassin playstyle of a Talon. You can bring in someone like Aurelia once again. You can bring in a lot of the beefy top laners that work very well in there, and Talon can't really do a lot up there. Same thing, you know, you're all the way in the top lane. One of Talon's strengths, roaming. He's not going to be able to do that nearly as much if he's up there, so we'll see what's going on there.
We definitely will have to see what goes on there as this game pans out a little and we see a few more of these picks coming through. It's clever if for no other reason that it is going to keep Dream very much guessing. It could be a placeholder. That does have to be said, as placeholder picks are being allowed right now. But even then, it seems like an odd thing to run as a placeholder, given that you could actually also play it. We are going to have to see how that pans out, though. That being said, if it is a Talon, this is a really, really all-in comp already from Doge, and that's just being further rounded out by the Corki there. Big burst damage that can come out of him. And I like the Amumu on top of that as well. Just, they've got about as much flexibility as you can have with a heavy engage type composition, because they can find some picks and go for more assassin type play. Even without the Amumu, they've got a strong team fight as they can burst down a lot of different targets at once. But then having the Amumu in there, as well as the Annie, of course, means that their full-on 5v5 team fight is scary enough that even a Team Dream that is ahead might hesitate to go in against it.
And when you look at the lineup coming out from Dream, and they're going to round it out with, I'm hoping that's a Zed, I'd like to see a Tamjong use Zed come out.
Yes. Oh, there it goes!
Yes! Anyway, so adding on to that, now that they've got Zed, that's a very all-in team comp. I mean, you're talking about Doge and they're all-in. Look at Dream, you've got Lee Sin, you've got Akali, you've got Zed, even Lucian to an extent, who likes to get up close and personal with his mobility. That's a very, very scary team composition, especially if you're one of the squishy champions in the backline. They've picked up Annie as well, who, while it's a champion that can add to their 5v5 team comp, if they don't get the wombo combo down, Stab's going to be a sitting duck. Zed can easily get straight onto Annie, so can Lee Sin, so can Akali. And at the same time, Peng Yilang, he doesn't have a support backing him up with Peel. I mean, Annie, it's very likely that stun's going to be used with the best tibbers possible. If that whiffs, if that doesn't quite work out, then Peng Yilang, he's relying on Valkyrie alone. And if that doesn't work, he's absolutely done for. They get through, the squishy's incredibly easy, and then they can turn around to the front line who, while they still do a lot of damage, because you've got Victor and Talon, who, you know, Victor's going to be in the back line soon again, another backline champion who doesn't have a lot of escape, going to be very vulnerable to the diving composition from Dream. There's not much left to deal with them, so I feel like it's going to be an all-or-nothing wombo combo for Doge right now.
I feel like it's going to be a bit of that for both of them. Actually, the thing I was just looking at, there is no Peel on either of these teams, really. I mean, there's the Thresh, but that's it.
Thresh is a lot of Peel.
In all truth, and I mean, granted, you could argue that Lee Sin has a bit of Peel if he really wants to use his Dragon's Rage for that, but that's pretty subpar. You want to be using that aggressively in a fight. What this means, though, once these teams are in a fight, that's it. They're in the fight. There is no getting away. You can't run from either of these teams. Look at them. They will mow you down. This is going to be just one hot match is all I can see from these two team comps. It's just going to be action all across the board. And if it's not, then I would be very surprised. I will eat my sock.
You'll eat your sock? Just the one? Not the other one?
If First Blood doesn't happen before 5 minutes, I will eat a sock.
Just a sock. All right. Yeah. Now you're just getting, you know, a little bit less specific. But in any case, Dream has...
Well, I can't eat the one on my foot because it's keeping that foot warm.
Yeah, no, that's kind of important. Dream has a very, very... I don't want to call it simple style to play this time, but that's what it is. Because all they've got to do is look out for the 5v5s. And one of the best options for that, it's going to be split pushing. It's splitting up the team wombo combo that's going to come out from Doge. And you can do that with all the champions they've got. They've got Zed, they've got Akali, both champions who are great duelists, are great at 1v1s. And seeing how well they laned last game, they're almost definitely going to be in the lead as well against their respective laners. All they need to do is, they could even go for a 1-3-1 kind of split push composition and force Doge to completely split up their team. And when you do that, their team comp just falls apart.
Very good point there. I kind of want to see how these teams play the early game, though. We can assume that Zensa is going to be going in the mid lane against the Zed, and that is going to be a victory against an Akali, which is almost like having two mid lane matchups. And I wonder which is going to go where. I think you made a very good point that the talent is more useful if he's able to roam, but I would argue that the Victor fits a similar niche. He's a little bit more useful when he's able to roam, and also has a bit more safety in a lane because of the gravity field that he can put down. I just want to see where these players are going to go, if nothing else, and also in terms of how the early game gets played out, whether or not we're going to see much aggression coming down onto Bonky Bonky straight off the bat. It's dangerous to invade against support Annie, especially with just the raw damage from Woofer Doge. But teams love invading a Mumu early.
That is true, but what I'm expecting to come out from Doge, yes, Doge, I think they didn't take advantage of it last game. I feel like what they should look for is maybe a lane swap. Both top laners are quite vulnerable to the 2v1. I mean, normally you see things like Shen or Aurelia who, or even, Shen and Aurelia, who can survive the 2v1s. They can handle it. They're not necessarily going to die, even if a 3 or 4v1 dive comes out. As long as they're on the ball, they'll be able to live through it. Akali and Zed, though, not quite so lucky. Akali and Victor. Unless Victor gets a perfect gravity field, stuns everyone underneath the turret, he's probably not going to get out of there alive. So a 2v1 could be on the table for either team here, especially with their duo lanes. I mean, a Corki and an Annie will absolutely decimate an Akali. It'll keep him completely zoned from any kind of farm. Same story with a Lucian and Thresh, completely zoning a Victor out, especially with the threat coming out from Death Sentence. So I'd like to see both teams go for the deepest vision they can, which is going to be completely different to what they did last game.
Yeah, you make an excellent point there, and we're going to have to see how they opt to play out this early game. Defensive pings as it is coming down from Woofer Doge, I think they just don't want that Amumu to be invaded, and you can almost always assume that if you have an Amumu, the other team is going to try to invade you. So playing defensively, I think, is smart on the one hand, but does hamstring them in terms of maybe establishing that lane swap like you talked about. That's potentially good for them. Potentially.
Yeah, so it looks like we're not going to see any kind of lane swap. Oh, that ward just got wrecked. There's your first blood.
The ward goes down. I'm eating a sock. No, I'm not. That's maybe a light nibble. I'll give it a lick. Sounded terrible.
That's just kind of worse.
Yeah. In any case, I'm maybe just going to start on the blue bar. Fairly standard stuff here. And it doesn't look like we're going to be having any lane swap. Annie, of course, sitting on that pre-cooked stun already. I wonder if Liberty and Bark are going to maybe try and find some early aggression. As much as you have to respect what can come out of the Corki, I think if with the Gromp, Liberty and Bark are able to get the early level 2, then they absolutely had the ability to lock down a kill early on in this game.
Well, I mean, look at Pengy Lang and Stab. They're on the opposite side of the map of their own jungle. They're going to get more experience out of the jungle camp that they're going to be taking. They're getting the Krugs, whereas Liberty and Bark, they're more helping O2-1 get that Gromp and trying to get a share of the experience, whereas Stab and Peng, they're going to get 100% of whatever they kill. So they're going to walk into the lane.
The whole Krug and nothing but the Krug.
I mean, they probably only took one of the Krugs, though, but it's still going to be a sizable XP difference there. I mean, if you have a look at the XP bars, I can see them. Pengy Lang, he's already well ahead, and a Corki at level 2, very, very dangerous against basically anyone that's level 1. Even if Thresh, you know, he has that death sentence, it's a big threat, but not until he's got Flay.
And Annie does actually have to cook that stun back up right now, and actually, Liberty and Bark are just manipulating the minion wave so well here that really trying to stop Stab from getting the opportunity to cook up any of those stuns, to use her abilities and get that stun ready to go. And, oh, nice catch on to Peng, but nothing coming out of it. But what they're doing, so for those wondering how they're doing that, is they're putting pressure on the minions, which means Peng has to clear the minions as fast as possible, which means Stab doesn't have the opportunity to use his abilities. This here is probably going to be the first time he's using a spell on a minion wave as it's being pushed onto the turret. Also, something I just noticed, Peng and Stab have swapped over.
Yes, yeah. I did try to mention that before, but you weren't having none of it. Bonky, he was pretty low, but he kept cool. Didn't let that red buff take him down. In any case, something you saw as soon as Liberty and Bark hit level 2, they knew exactly when it was happening, and they used that to get a nice sizable lead. You can already see their health pot up, they're looking good in the advantage, and, you know, once the skirmish is going to start coming along, hang on though, there is a gank in the top lane.
flash out from Kun to start with. He took a chunk of damage there, and the red buff burn is a little bit unfortunate. But of course, he's already been doing a good job of bullying IU a bit in that lane, which is definitely what you need to be doing early. So, good move by OG1. He probably wasn't even looking for the kill, just needed to get some pressure and alleviate the pressure on IU.
We may be seeing a bit of roaming coming down from the mid lane. Zensa looking for a kill. Liberty and Barkbar completely blind to this. And they're known for being pretty aggressive. Can Zensa find a kill? I kind of hope so.
Zed did give the AFK ping, so they know that something might be going on. Liberty dashing back. There's no stun from Annie. It's only just come back up, and Zensa's gone out. First blood! And there it is, under 5 minutes. So no sock eating for me. Zensa picking that one up. Really good roam. Even as it was pinged out, and Liberty didn't blow his flash.
Yeah, Liberty, I mean, you talk about how good he is at holding onto his flash. Probably could have used it then to get out safety, but instead just letting it go down. First blood to Talon. Now, that's going to be pretty important. Usually gives him a pretty good advantage against his enemy mid laner, but look at it. He suffered a big creep score difference to go and do that. Yes, he's picking up his Brutalizer, but we see Tam Jong Q. He's going for a recall too. He's got his own Brutalizer, so it's no real huge advantage because he gave up a lot of CS to go and get that kill down there.
What we really need to see in that mid lane before long is Bonky Bonky making some moves there to secure a kill for his mid laner on Tam Jong, and really just turn that from being a first kill but a loss of CS to an out and out lead for Zensa.
Oh no, 0-2-1.
Oh yeah.
He's looking to get a bit of revenge, and I think
Oh, there it goes! Tam Jong goes aggressive. OG1 doesn't find Zensa. The moment Tam Jong went in, he went, something's fishy, I'm gonna get out of here. And that is exactly what he will do.
Yeah, so Zensa definitely reading Dream a little bit better this game, keeping a little bit more safe. That's something that's not terribly easy to do on a Zed before level 6. Hang on though!
Oh, Bark! Roaming all the way up, finds Zensa, taken out. Before he even knows what's going on. Really nice roam there. I didn't even notice the ping coming out from the bottom lane. They must have just assumed that Bark was off warning there. Nice moves by him.
So that's going to bring it a little bit more in favor of Tam Jong Q, and that's got to be a scary thought for Doge right now. As Zed in the lead is... I'm trying to think of a saying that rhymes. Zed indeed. Yeah, that's
no,
it.
That's just that'll work.
No.
No, it kind of is.
I mean, Zed's... All right. Whatever. In any case, the gold's now a bit more in favor of Dream. Once again, despite not getting that first blood, they're doing the same thing. They're quite ahead in CS in both of the lanes. Not quite so much in the bottom lane, but that's where first blood happens. But you can see right now, Peng and Stab going for a bit of zoning, taking advantage of Barkbark not quite being in lane anymore. So it's not like Doge are getting completely rolled over here. They are definitely fighting back and playing a lot better than they did last game.
I think I've got it. A Zed in the lead is worse for you than Creed. Ah. It's a cheap shot. It's a cheap shot, but it rhymes, alright? Whatever. It's better than what you did.
Just
fire that shot nice and quick. The semi-roam coming down from Tam Jong does look like it's just going to be a ward. Actually, no, it's not, but yes, it is going to be a ward. It looked for a minute like he was really wanting to circle, stab, and ping, but in any case, it was pinged out that he was AFK from lane, that he was away from his lane and potentially roaming, so Doge really not going to let that Zed go anywhere. But then again, does Zed really need to go anywhere? Indeed. Oh, as they're being turned around upon, Liberty. No, he's able to just dash his way out of there, but that's really the burst from Corky. IU has actually roamed a long way down, and he doesn't really have any friendly members here. Maybe they just want to find Stab, flash forward, looking for it, Bark can't follow it up with that Q, but IU, he is following it up, manages to find it. Wow. As what I was saying before, once these teams are on you, there's no running away from them. They will find a way to mow you down, even if it means a flash dash and stab.
To be fair, that's Stab on Annie, one of the champions that doesn't have any escapes. But again, it does show the pursuing power that comes out from the composition of almost everyone on Dream. They're going to pick up the first dragon, no contest at all. Khan being smart, holding onto his teleport, but that's not going to be terribly smart for too long as look who's arrived.
Tam Jong looking for Kun. That was a really nice gravity well, but the hailstorm leaving with Tam Jong. He just swept that up easy as pie.
Yeah, and that Zed is going to get scarier and scarier as we go later on. I said it in Champion Select, I've been saying it for most of this game. So many of the champions on Doge are easy targets for someone like Tamjong Q on that Zed. He's able to just get in so easily and not even be punished for it because he's Zed, because he can get out incredibly easy. Tamjong Q, one of the higher rated mid lane players, even in the Oceanic region. Obviously, if you watched the last Oceanic University Championship, he made it to the finals, he played mid lane there and did very, very well, even against the team that did end up beating them. So, on a champion like Zed, he's so hard to punish, especially when you don't even have a good team that deals with the Zed in the back line.
Look at that, though, just the synergy between Liberty and Barkbark in the bottom lane. We talk about how good these players are, but it was a really, really long roam by Zenser. They got completely nullified by
Hang on,
one
look at that jungle.
Yeah, a bit of a skirmish in the jungle. It's just going to be new love taps from Tamjong to Bonky Bonky saying, hey, yeah, I'm around here. Careful, got my eye on you. And that is actually that ward being put to good use there. Actually, Peng and Stab can't really afford to leave this lane to help out Bonky Bonky. So Bonky Bonky, he's going to look for something a little bit different, maybe. Actually, he doesn't look like he's completely sure what to do, just kind of hovering around the bottom side of the jungle. Meanwhile, O2-1, he's going to take advantage of it, pick up that Scuttle Crab, get some extra vision, and maybe apply some pressure to this bottom lane.
Yeah, and there's not a huge amount to be gained around the bottom lane just because right now there's no dragon to take. But that said, Dream, they're an aggressive team composition. They're looking for kills, looking for roams, and Peng just walked into this one.
Who's the aggressive one now? What a Tempest! 0-2-1! 5-2-1-0-7-6-1. Totally snapped up and taken down and out for the count. That's actually
That wasn't even a number.
But hold on, here's Tamjong. Is he going to be able to turn it around? No, he's not. Barkbark takes the stun now. Peng, he's finding the damage there. Here comes Bonky Bonky. Nice big stun, but he doesn't get anyone important. Stab, he's low. Peng, he's having to flee away. Liberty throwing down a massive culling. Bonky Bonky and Stab are trying to stay on him. Actually, Bonky Bonky, he might have it. Stab, he has the damage, and that's enough. That got totally flipped on its head. I was not expecting that to go as well as it did for Woofer Doge, but there you have it.
Oh, and that smoke bomb is not going to keep you safe from the Chaos Storm.
But it did. It didn't look like I was taking any damage there.
Gives him a little bonus defenses, but, you know, he's still taking damage from it. He's still not able to hide from it, is the main point. And he did have to escape rather than continue down on the kill on come there. So it did keep him alive. The smoke bomb, not as much of an asset as it would be against a lot of other top laners anyway. In any case, he's forced out of lane despite him, you know, recalling anyway. What are they going to take advantage out of here? We've got O2-1 roaming up to the top lane. Is he looking to hide in the bush, go for a counter gank, or go for some kind of different engage onto Khan? No dragon, so he can afford to be in this top lane.
Also, my apologies to whoever's phone number I just said on stream. Viewers, please do not try and call that number. I don't know if it exists, and if it does, I am in trouble.
You didn't even say the number that, like, the player's name is, but hang on. No.
Khan. Well, I just wanted to rhyme it with one, but Khan getting completely caught out. Nice gravity field, but there comes the flying kicker pal. And still running. There
Made
we go.
Work O2-1. For it.
O2-1 snaps it up.
And they even blew a flash in there as well without using any summoner spells of their own. So that's just such an easy kill. You've got to always be aware of where that Lee Sin could be. You know that he's not on the other side of the map. You know that
he's hungry for it.
There's
he's
no dragon.
Uh-oh. Didn't want to go in for it, though. Was not willing to engage with O2-1 there. That's actually really telling.
You do have to always be careful, especially on Lee Sin. You know, you can go for those flashy plays if you want, but a lot more often than not, there's always the risk of them completely backfiring. He didn't know where the enemy jungler was, didn't know where Victor was either. I mean, he's just respawned and on his way back, but you've always got to keep an eye on things like that.
No,
so
Zenser didn't go in. That's the thing Zenser, that I was amazed
that's
about.
What,
yeah.
That's what you're worried about.
Zenser was right there. He even had Bonky Bonky fairly close in hand. And they had a ward over that side. They could see where O2-1 was, and they could see that no one else was around him. Now, really, they just got bluffed out of their minds there. They just assumed that O2-1 wouldn't possibly be warding there without friendly champions around, and there was actually no one. Zenser could have got a nice, easy kill there.
Alright, we've got Dragon coming up in 1 minute. We've got junglers looking to head, or at least the Bonky Bonky. He's down on the bottom lane. He's completely spotted out by a ward, though. O2-1, he's heading up to the top lane. Once Doge are able to spot this out, they might be able to take advantage of a dragon fight. They do have good ultimates. They can combine the Curse of the Sad Mummy and the Tibbers to look for a very good mid-game teamfight around that dragon and even things up in that regard. So as soon as they see O2-1 near the top lane, they should definitely go looking for that as an advantage. Yes, they might lose Khan to a kill, they might lose a tower up there, but that's only a maybe. If they see O2-1 up in the top lane, they can definitely get that dragon.
They absolutely can. They're really just waiting for it. I want to talk about a bit of the vision game here, though. Actually, hold on. Seven Bonky Bonky. Looking for something. They found Bark Bark. Flash for the damage. Not quite enough just yet. Bonky Bonky. Maybe he even wants to die for this. Isn't quite feeling it. Bark Bark taken very low, but is able to get out. That's Tibbers down, though. That weakens their strength around the Dragon Pit. And now maybe opens it up for Dream to make that play as O2-1 moves towards this bottom side of the map.
Yeah, they may have been looking to War Spark back out of play.
Temjong, though. Oh, Zengsir! Zengsir and Temjong, they're both gone for it. The Ignite is down on Temjong, now the Ignite is down on Zengsir! That's not enough damage on Zengsir to kill him. Oh, or is it?
O2-1, though. O2-1's coming in.
They came off so even, and it really was just that Zengsir was the one who started the fight. Now, O2-1, he might actually find Zengsir. Zengsir needs to get out of here as fast as he can. He manages to dodge the Q, and in the interim, Woofer Doge pick up the dragon. That ended up turning out pretty nicely for them, as sketchy as it seemed.
Alright. So they managed to pick up the dragon and all the confusion that happened there, and a good play by Zengsir, knew his strengths and was able to get in there. Temjong Q, not quite able to pick up that revenge kill, even with that ignite, even with that Bilgewater Cutlass. But that said, you know, mentioning that item, he's very, very close to being able to pick up that Blade of the Ruined King, and once he does, an engage like that gain from Zengsir could tell a different story. He'll get that health back, get a little bit more damage, even the movement speed could add into the fight, so those power spikes are going to be coming up soon. The teleport's coming down to the bottom lane, though. It's interrupted!
Coming down what a gravity field. Totally stunned. Now we're out. O2-1, he wants to go right in. Gets stunned up on the backside, though. As Zengsir goes aggressive, finds Temjong before Temjong can even do anything in the fight. That's also Bonky Bonky. Sorry, Bark Bark going down. O2-1 now the one having to run away. Bonky Bonky is going to be able to find that one. And the last second damage. The Chaos Storm finds it as Victor snaps that one up. That was almost an ace. Liberty's the only one who got out of that. Woofer Doge, they've finally cracked it. They've finally managed to punish the over-aggressive plays coming out from Team Dream.
And I've got to give it to Khan there. Interrupting that teleport must have been crucial, because without the Akali support down there, they didn't have the power to finish off that team fight. Tibbers wasn't even used there. They got an excellent Curse of the Sad Mummy off, and we saw O2-1 go in a little bit too aggressive right into the enemy backline. Didn't have an Akali to back him up. Didn't even have Temjong Q there. He was locked up by Curse of the Sad Mummy. And so it all comes back to that teleport interrupt. Congrats to Khan for good playing, making such a crucial play.
Can I also just say, I mentioned it really early on, you know, these teams, they don't have a whole heap of peel. I mean, some of them have a bit of escape, but they don't have much peel. Once they're in the fight, they're in the fight. And I was saying that actually maybe Annie was a little bit of a weakness there. In that team fight, it ended up being the opposite thing. Dab punished O2-1 for going into the fight, which is exactly what O2-1 wants to do. The moment O2-1 went deep, he was stunned up and split from the rest of his team. And that was incredible play by Stab. Instead of using the stun for some crazy aggressive Tibbers, Dab played a lot more reserved and held it to punish Dream's aggression, which is exactly what we've been saying Doge need to do.
Oh, he probably wanted to use Tibbers. It was just on cooldown, unfortunately. But in any case, it was definitely a good pickup there. They're going to walk right past this pink ward. No, come on, Zengsir. He got it.
Yeah,
they do have O2-1 a little bit cornered in their own jungle. Are they going to be able to spot him? They don't have any wards in their own jungle. Oh, he's just going to recall.
They don't know he's there. Oh, the ninja.
Liberty dropping incredibly low.
Doesn't even have to recall. Just walks out of the jungle. Actually, he might be able to get the drop on Kun up here. Gonna try and sneak around from the backside where I've heard that before. IU though, that's the Twilight Shroud already going down. Akali going aggressive. O2-1, he's gonna try and come in from the backside, but Akali's already low. Oh, what a flash as the Q whiffs. And Kun is just gonna get out alive.
And while that was all going on, being able to force Liberty out of lane allowed Doge to take out a free turret in the bottom lane. That's going to be important in a few minutes once the dragon comes up. They're going to have a whole lot of extra space to work with. They're still going on the offensive there, trying to use their numbers advantage to get that turret down on the top lane. The same story's not quite happening in the top lane for Dream. They had a numbers advantage. 0-2-1, force the recall, get out of there. Come though, his tower's dropping a little bit low. IU could be in a great position for a dive here.
Really is. If he can get the damage, there's the gravity well, that's one he has to look out for. He still gets stunned up by it, but there's a minion wave. He can dash to safety. Do we have Zanza coming up and wanting to try and clean it up, but Pam Jog knows what's up and he's ready for it as well. But Zanza, maybe he's already found IU. No, he hasn't. Not enough damage. Zanza gets shut down, turned around upon IU. The burn is there, but oh, it is enough. Just barely enough. And
that's
all
a bit
across
depressing.
The board, it is a 2-for-1.
And Tamjong Q, using his spider senses, can almost hear the footsteps of Stab coming up to stab him in the back in the darkness of the little triangle bush up there. Tri-bush, that's what it is. Triangle bush. He's able to use a little bit of intuition there and get out to safety and not give away a free kill for nothing. Now, while there's not a huge amount happening on the map, just have a look at the mini-map. You can see just how much of an advantage.
What a mini-map it is.
It's beautiful.
I mean, whoever drew that, just pay them more.
look at the red hordes. Dream have got so much control in the top side of the map, whereas it's almost mirrored down on the bottom side. It's not quite as deep in the enemy jungle for Doge, but they've got that dragon on lockdown. There's around the banana bush, they could probably get a little bit more advantage, but if they can get that, and you can already see Zenza moving around to pick up that pick ward and lay down his own, there may even be a trap for Zed. No, he's going to walk away from it. Once they get this vision down, dragon that's spawning in 40 seconds is going to be on lockdown for them if they can get their team down there.
Yeah, and there's a lot of work Dream would have to put in to try and take control themselves. I don't know if they actually even have the time to do it. Dragon coming up in just over 20 seconds. Now, they did clear out a few wards, but in any case, the control is definitely still in favor of Doge right now. Just need to find it, and maybe this is the moment they're going to look for the fight. Both top laners' teleports are available. They might both look to go in. Smites are up for both junglers as well. Bonky Bonky, a little bit less healthy, but he does have that huge ultimate. 0-2-1 gets caught out, able to jump away. Actually, Bonky Bonky! He's taking dragon aggro! His team isn't there! And the Hunter becomes the Hunted! The Curse of the Sad Mummy had to use defensively. That's so unfortunate. That's really all the ability that Doge had to contend with the dragon. It's gone now.
And that's the wombo down. That means this dragon, unless some kind of miracle happens, no, it's not. Dragon easily goes number two over to Dream right now. And, you know, that's just showing what happens when you take one key component out of the composition of Doge. They're not able to get the wombo combos down, which means they're not even going to attempt to go for a team fight. Hang on!
Oh, you say that, and then Liberty gets stunned up by a big bad bear, Bark Bark, now onto the side, trying to run away as fast as you can. You can't catch him, he's the gingerbread. Fresh as Peng gets caught up by the death status. It could be exactly that, as Ultimate is off to the side. Not quite. Peng just gonna helicopter away as fast as he can. Mary had a little lamb.
Yep, so bringing that back into what I was saying, yes, they might not want to go for even team fights. They saw an opportunity in mid lane to go for more of a pick, not quite a team fight. So I wasn't 100% wrong there. But in any case, you can see...
You're just 80% wrong.
80%, yeah, whatever. So you can see how Dream reacted to that. They decided to not even go for a 5v5 because they know that they don't need to. They sent Tamjong Q, split pushing in the bottom lane. He's got his Blade of the Ruined King. He's the 1v1 king right now, except for maybe Zenza, who, if he's lucky enough, is able to burst him down straight away. But Zenza is crucial to the team fights too. He needs to be in there for the wombo combo to add that extra damage. I mean, Zenza and his Shadow Assault, you know, it does do a lot of damage. Yes, it's good for burst on a single target and escaping, but there's a lot of collateral damage that comes out of it too. So he needs to be there in those 5v5s as well. So can't necessarily always deal with Tamjong Q and his split.
Yeah, nice push here coming out from Dream. One thing we haven't talked much about, actually, is just the general push power coming out of these team comps. And I would definitely say it falls slightly in the favor of Dream, because that Lucian and the Zed can either strongly push separate waves or push a single wave so quick, you know, you blink and your minions are dead. Which means a lot of pressure on Toast, but hold on, Bulkybook is going aggressive, but a nice catch by Barkbuck onto Zenser.
Whoa.
Not even going to pay off, though. Liberty just
Where
disappeared from the map.
Where did they go? The health bars are just gone.
He just took a nap. Look at him, he's lying down in the middle of the mid lane.
That's a bit lazy, but just look at that. That's what they can do, and that's only against two members, but it's going to be the exact same thing against an entire team. A lot of that was AoE damage. There was a little bit of single target coming out from Zenser, but it's going to be the same thing in 5v5s, and that's why you can see Tam Jong-Q split pushing in the bottom lane. Khan's not going to be able to hold off against him, and Doge are just going to look for as much of a team fight as they can right now. Ultimates, a few of them on cooldown, so they're going to look for maybe something else. Try and defend against that split push.
Thing is, though, that's exactly how you punish the split push. I mean, they know that they've got the slightly stronger team fight, and they also know that Dream have a fairly good split push if they really want to go for it. The moment they do try and go for it, and Doge have that bottom side of the map watered up, so they know if someone's going for it. The moment that happens, they can just go for a team fight. They can go for a 5-on-4 or a 5-on-3 or however many members they have to find, really, and punish the main push. Yeah, sure, there's still a split push putting some pressure down, but let's get real. Is one Zed going to push harder than five whole members of Doge?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely going to be on the minds of Doge right now. They can definitely deal with a split push Zed by just completely rushing the enemy team. We said it in Champions League. Not a lot of peel. Barkbuck, yeah, Fresh can add a lot of peel, but when Zenza's just on your AD carry in an instant, there's not a whole lot you can do. I mean, Barkbuck, he's an excellent support. He is definitely very skilled at keeping his AD carries alive, but you've got to have godlike reactions to keep that Talon straight off of your AD carry. You have to almost predict the movement. So it's very easy to dive and punish a comp that's trying to go for a split push instead.
That it very much is. O2-1 trying to keep control of the vision around this Baron Pit. He's doing a fairly good job of this, and this is actually a point at which Doge maybe want to start turning their attention to the top side of the map to get some vision up there, because of course the Baron is live, and we've already seen them fumble a little bit around the Dragon Pit. Baron is somewhere Dream, maybe feeling a bit more confident to make a play, or even better, make a bait.
Yeah, Dream though, they've got to be careful at any kind of bait. I mean, unless they're catching up one of the squishies, which...
It's got to be a masterful bait.
But to be fair, oh wow, the flash force down. In fact, a bit of a fight going on there. Deathmark down.
Couldn't taking a bit of damage from that, but it's not really enough, I think, to justify that cooldown being used. That being said, it isn't a very long cooldown, and given that Doge have to clear out this mid lane, I think that could still leave Dream enough time to have that back up before the next fight, be it a dragon or in the mid lane or anywhere.
Okay, looking at pings on the map right now, despite Bonky Bonky getting a bit of a death sentence there, they know that IU is in the bottom lane. They know they've got the advantage. In fact, they may even be guessing that Liberty's going for a recall. They're pinging this mid lane. They know they can push faster, and that's exactly how this is going to go. What are Dream going to do about it?
They need to just find it. They need to just go in now. Actually, there's going to be a teleport to the bottom lane. I wonder if that's the right call, actually, going down there. The turret was down, and it's definitely the wrong call. IU just finds Kun. What a punished teleport. They could have just stayed in the mid lane and found a fight, maybe even found an inhibitor, but now suddenly they're on the back foot. It's four members of Woofer Doge on a hasty retreat as Dream are looking to catch them unawares, or even catch a Baron, the very big net.
Yeah, and that's such a slip-up as well by Doge. They're going down to the bottom lane. Are you saying, yep, I'm in trouble here, but everyone else, go for Baron.
Yeah, he's not even in that much trouble. He just got out.
The Timbers was
goodness,
used too.
Why send that many members to find one person? They just gave up so much ground for no good reason after what was actually a really good play. They did it right the first time when they saw the split push. They just went, all right, we're fighting, we're doing it now. They got two kills on two crucial members and they pushed it to advantage. That time, they looked like they were so on track, and then they just kind of lost their way. They went, oh, hold on, we need to stop that, and panicked.
Yeah, the thing about Akali, yes, the champion is a great duelist, great at 1v1. We saw what happened when Kun arrived to defend that turret. But he's not necessarily an excellent split pusher. Has a little bit of attack damage from Gunblade, but nothing like a Zed, nothing like any of the typical split pushers, so it's more of a slow threat than any other kind of split push. You have to deal with it eventually, but if you push as 5, you're not going to lose too much ground. They could have easily got another turret, like you said. But that said, you know, they've got to now deal with Dream that have Baron. And despite their team fights being so great, is it going to be enough to defeat them in an even 5v5, even with Baron?
Pretty hard call to make, actually. I feel like Bonky Bonky was potentially the most powerful part of this team composition, but we've actually yet to see him really pull out an amazing Curse the Sad Mummy. And seeing as they missed the opportunity to go for that Baron Pit fight a few minutes back, and also whiffed the earlier Dragon Pit fight, Bonky Bonky's relevance in terms of these team fights is slowly diminishing. The further the game goes on, the more confident Dream are going to get in just ignoring Bonky Bonky and continuing with the fight anyway. Because look at what they've got. They've got enough damage that they can possibly even kill people before the Curse of the Sad Mummy goes down. And even then, the moment the stun is lifted, they probably still have enough damage to finish the job.
We can see Khan hiding out in the top side of
the
map.
Oh, Spencer walks into the trap, Liberty from the side with the culling, and that is one dead Talon. IU finds Khan. Khan, though, with the Zonyas, is actually just going to give Dream more time to collapse on him. And now Dream, again, it's a little bit later, but they're putting on the gas.
And it was looking so good for Doge right now. It could have been the comeback that they needed to tie it up to 1v1 for 1. But it's slipping up in the late game. You could see the story from the start of the game, or Tamjong could be in trouble.
Bonky Bonky finds Tamjong, actually, that's a chunk of damage. Now Bonky Bonky getting turned around upon. Stab is there, though, nice stun plus the Zonyas. That's going to be Tamjong going down. Peng just coming in the last minute there to secure it. But that's maybe a few too many members for one person. And this is the same thing again.
It's
like they did it so well
up
the first time. And then all of a sudden Doge forgot how to play against a split push. And they got so punished there.
Yeah, with split pushes, you send two people max to go and deal with it. You cannot send most of your team, especially when there are other objectives on the map to deal with. You saw that happen with Baron. You saw that happen with an easily pushed down inhibitor. And the fact that they sent three members down, they lost people defending the turret. They were just taken by surprise when they should honestly have been prepared against it. When you're going for a wombo combo, of course the enemy team is going to look for a split push comp. And Tamjong Q, despite dying, is buying so much for his team.
And even then, you've got the better team fight. Just take the 5v4. You don't even need to kill the one guy. Like I said before, what's really going to push faster? All five members of your team or their one Zed? And now they've probably lost that grace period. Now actually they do have to be afraid of the Zed because they've got an exposed inhibitor. Ignoring him means losing the game. They had so much time beforehand to play this right and punish the split push the Dream were going for quite greedily. And now that they've not done that, they've kind of lost a lot of their window of opportunity. Actually, as I say, that huge big stunt goes down, but this is cleanses it out. Now Zenser is the focus. They didn't even kill Bonky from Firefox, sorry, and even then he was the wrong target. IU picking up the stab, and now IU with the Zonyas is going to stay nice and healthy as 0-2-1 keeps Kun and Peng on the back foot as they flee as fast as they can. Tamjong,
and look in the bottom lane.
Now, see, and this is exactly what I was just saying. That time, Woofer Doge tried to do the right thing and just take the 5v4, but they have lost the window where they can do that. It's not safe for them to go for that anymore. Even worse, if it blows up in their face, they end up in an even worse position than before because the Zed is still there putting on aggression. And look at this, 0-2-1 still stopping the bags as Zed gets onto the inhibitor turret.
Yeah, so that inhibitor is going to be the second one to go down. I really don't see Tamjong being... Actually, no, he's being scared away.
That with the home guard is really all that kept him off that. And even then, he's just hovering around, waiting for Woofer Doge to back away from that inhibitor so that he can sweep in and pick it up again.
Doge are definitely not out right now, for sure. I definitely see them able to come back from this. They've got the defense that they need. They've got great team fights. And Dream, we saw it last game. They might be more on the ball in this game, but they do like to do flashy plays when they're ahead. They do like to go for things that are a little bit risky. I mean, they're going for Bonky Bonky
plays
now. It's a squishy Amumu.
That's a really, really nice one, actually. Following the Amumu over the wall, knowing that IU is right behind Bark Bark, take the Thresh Express, follow him over there into those little birds. Tamjong finds Kun. I don't think... Oh, no, Peng is there as well. Or maybe Tamjong wants to fight, pick a fight with both. Now IU is there as well. Kun, the Zonyas is down, but he's gonna be in trouble here, or is it? No! IU getting turned around upon Zenser flying in at the last minute there.
That's what I'm talking about.
Kill.
That's what I'm talking about with Dreams plays. They try to go for flashy plays. They try to go for risky, high payoff but high risk plays. And sometimes it backfires. I mean, looking at them, they're 7,000 gold ahead. It's not a huge deal. They still have the inhibitor down. It's not going to make them lose by any sense. They can afford to make these mistakes, but if anything's going to bring Doge back, it's going to be that.
And you're dead right, Doge. If Dream go for a high-risk, high-reward play, then Doge need to be the ones that make sure it was too risky a play. They need to make sure that it doesn't pay off, rather than leaving it down to the chance and the skill of Dream. They can't rely on Dream to whiff. It's just not going to happen often enough to put you back into this game. And Dream picking up their third dragon now. That's actually going to be really huge as they try and pincer in on this base.
I'm sort of surprised that Dream... I feel like they're still not taking this as seriously as they should be. Like I said last game, both from University of Auckland, they've definitely played off against each other a lot, I definitely say. So Dream probably have a fair idea where they stand against Doge. But there's so much on the line right now. If Doge don't win this game, they're completely out. I mean, Dream are just a few minutes away from moving into the next round, looking to represent New Zealand in the next stage of the University Championship. But they're still just not taking it seriously. Yes, they've got a one-game grace loss period if they need to, but do you think they should maybe start taking the last few minutes a bit seriously? That's all they need.
I would definitely agree. And the hook goes a little bit wide on Bonky Bonky. That actually could have been the game-closing play there if that had it connected, but I think you're dead right. And, hold on! Oh, they're turning back around to the Baron. They could have actually completely given Woofer Doge the slip.
They need to go now.
That's not their plan. Cam Jong, he's got the split push. This is why Dream is sticking around. They want to stop the backs.
That's the question.
Three members are trying to back. It's only fresh around. They didn't find any of them, and now it is. Denser is already back. Bonky Bonky gets caught up. He's going to go down. Is that going to be enough pressure, though? Dream are definitely closing it in. The claws are tightening the vice grip.
And the indecisiveness there.
Like a clam here. OG1 on the top side. They're looking for it. Going a little bit of focus here. Goes down the gravity well, doesn't catch anyone. Culling from the side. Here's Peg though. He's back alive. Bonky Bonky still a long time till he's back up. But they find IU. That could break the siege here. Denser going aggressive. Finds the thresh on the back line but goes down himself. Now Tamjo going aggressive. Punished for it. Gets out by the skin of his teeth, the ignite ticking on him, and has this broken the siege. There's still OG1, there's still Liberty, and they're still looking for damage, but the longer they hold on, the sooner Bonky Bonky comes back to life, and that could be everything they need here. Dream, still just barely unable to close out the game.
Yeah, that was a bit of a cheeky engage there. They managed to pick up the inhibitor at the same time during that fight, so all three inhibitors down. That usually means a free Baron for the enemy team, and that's exactly what we're going to see here, because Doge can't leave their base, they can't risk getting picked off, let alone going for any kind of teamfight attempt at stopping them doing Baron. So this is going to be a free Baron over to Dream, and if you're Doge, you don't have another game to try and come back. You've got to be thinking about the last few minutes of this game and what must be going through their minds right now? What's going through Bonky Bonky's mind?
Well, I was going to say, what should be going through Bonky Bonky's mind is stay in the base and wait for them to come to me. Oh, the Zonyas, it could be enough.
Calculated.
Oh, how cheeky, Bonky Bonky just barely staying alive. I don't know if that was all planned or a fluke, but in any case, that's the sort of thing Doge need.
And nah, mate. Bonky Bonky calculated.
Bonky Bonky needs to stick in the base, wait for Dream to come to them, and hold tight. He needs to get the perfect Curse of the Sad Mummy. And that is going to be what turns this game around, because it is getting late in the game. There is a lot of damage and a lot of mobility from Woofer Doge. If they get an ace, they could charge down Dream's base. There's only the one inhibitor turret left in the mid lane.
That needs to be a huge ace, though. They need to have at least an AD carry up, and probably someone else as well. And even then, it's still probably going to take two or three team fights, and we could see one of those happening right away. Doge
Bonky Bonky already half health as the Nexus turrets get aggressed upon. Liberty gets the top one. The Super Minions have done so much work, and this is the reality of it. Well, for Doge, they're fighting an enemy team and Super Minion staff. He's nearly going down to minions there. Look at how low he is already. He can't even get close to the enemy team. Hell, they don't even look interested in taking down the Nexus. It's wide open. They're just waiting for IU. Gonna let Super Minions do the work. Pincer it slowly. If it's gonna be a fight, it's gotta be now. But Bonky Bonky's already low. Curse the Sand Mummy only finds one! As Liberty cleanses out the stun, Zenster forced to use his ultimate just to sneak away on the backside. Does. No, it's couldn't against Liberty, but that's only the one. Actually, Cam Jong a bit too aggressive now, but they've got to stop the super minions. That's gonna be it. And Woofer Doge just got distracted by the fight around them as the Nexus got hammered away at by the super minions. That's what happens when all three of your inhibitors go down. Good game to Dream, taking out the series in a dominant 2-0 sweep.
And that means Dream from the University of Auckland are going to be representing New Zealand in the next stage, going into the group round robin, where they play off for the top two spot to move into the grand finals of the Oceanic University Championship, where they get flown to Sydney to play at the Riot Games office. They're not quite there yet. They got it last time. We'll see if they can get it again. All they've got to get through is the best from a few of the other regions in Oceania and their best university teams. But judging by their performance so far in New Zealand, there is no better team to send there right now.
Yeah, just a few of the best. That's all they've got to get through. The big thing to be looking out for with them, though, and you were saying this quite a bit, they weren't taking that game as serious as they could have been. And you certainly hope that they're maybe going to look to be a bit more serious as they move further into this tournament. And I think if they do, they could very well be a contender for first place here. In any case, that is all we have for you today, guys. The two Auckland teams playing off against one another. And once again, it was Dream taking it, taking the win there. Congratulations to them. And thank you very much, everyone, for tuning in. I have been Matt, Pixie, Carol, and casting with me today has been Matt Smite Ross. And we will see you next weekend as the tournament continues.